Nancy Netzer, Director of the McMullen Museum and Professor of Art History here at Boston College. And on behalf of our university, I want to extend a warm welcome to all of you and to thank you for coming. This afternoon's lecture amplifies the scholarly contribution of our exhibition upstairs, Nature's Mirror, Reality and Symbol in Belgian Landscape. The exhibition started life in Jeffrey Howe's lifelong study of Belgian symbolist art. And throughout his distinguished career as a scholar and professor of art history at Boston College, Professor Howe maintained a close relationship with an inspired, knowledgeable, and gifted collector in the field, Charles Hack, who over the past 40 years has built the premier assemblage of Belgian art in North America for the Hermitage Trust. In anticipation of his retirement from teaching at the end of this academic year, Professor Howe proposed curating one more exhibition in his area of expertise, drawing principally on works in the unparalleled and extensive Hearn Trust collection. Charles Hack generously agreed, and the two set about reviewing the Hearn holdings to define a focus for the exhibition. At first, they proposed an examination of the symbolist landscape. But as they dug deeper, they realized the collection had a larger story to tell about how and why landscape developed from the late Middle Ages to the early 20th century in Belgium as a significant artistic genre. One of the scholars who aided them in developing that larger story is renowned art historian of Belgian art, Sura Levine, who is professor of art history and dean of humanities, arts, and cultural studies at Hampshire College. Professor Levine received her PhD from the University of Chicago, specializing in the social history of 19th and 20th century European and American art. And she contributed an essay to the McMullen's catalog for the exhibition, A New Key, Modern Belgian Art from the Simon Collection, also curated by Jeffrey Howe. Professor Levine has published widely in museum catalogs and scholarly journals, primarily on Belgian art, and in particular on the artist Constantine Meunier. She's currently working on topics related to the Holocaust, especially as it pertains to artists active in Belgium during World War II. Today, she'll speak to us about a slightly earlier period in Scorched Earth, Belgian Artists, and the Industrial Landscape. So please join me in welcoming Sura Levine back to Boston College.
Good afternoon, can you hear me? And Nancy, thank you so much for that wonderful introduction. And Jeff, thank you for doing this. This is a really lovely show, and really path-breaking in so many ways. So feel really proud and really good about having done it. I'm just delighted to participate in this way. I'm here to talk with you about a part of this history that has a very small section in the exhibition. And part of that has to do, of course, with budgetary issues and availability of objects. Most of the objects that you'll be seeing are not in this country. And so for that reason, it becomes very hard to create a section on the industrial landscape, a side that is from my collection, which I should tell you is as idiosyncratic as is Jeff's and my love of Belgian art. And it's one of those things where it develops over time. If I'm really honest, Nancy asked me how I got to Belgium. And I came to Belgium intellectually through 15th century Flanders, looking at religious painting, doing iconographic studies. And that I was doing my graduate work at University of Chicago, and directly in front of the library was the magisterial life-sized figure of a metallurgist by Constantin Meunier. So every day when I'd go into the library, because I also worked there, I would see this, I'd say hello to it, became a very good friend, as are many of the pieces upstairs. Eventually, Meunier became the topic of my lifelong career on Belgian art, but if truth be told, it's really childhood. I don't imagine that anybody would argue that it isn't the best chocolate in the world. My talk today, Scorched Earth, is meant to reference not almost a character. Serial form in Belgium in the book in 1886, and remember that date, 1886, to understand the heat, noxious fumes, and even explosions that killed hundreds of miners in northern France and Belgium in the late 19th century. I would like to begin with three quotes that I hope will set the stage for three of the many polemics on the Belgian working class and the industrial sector in the 1880s, and as well about the representation of the industrial sector. The first is from King Leopold II's royal decree, calling for a commission du travail, a study on labor, on 9 November 1886, and he wrote, "The situation of the working class is highly deserving of interest, and it will be the duty of the legislature to seek, with an increased solicitude, for improving their situation." The second quote is by Camille de Meunier, the Belgian Zola, a naturalist writer, whose novel Hampshire, also from 1886, focused on the coal mining districts. In Le Meunier's case, he looked at the coal mines in the Black Country and the Borinage. Le Meunier's quote here is from 1872, and is a call to artists associated with the Free Art Society, La Société Libre des Beaux-Arts, to look at contemporary subjects in their imagery. And just for background's sake, a number of the artists upstairs were involved in the Société. Including Constantin Meunier, and were very much involved in thinking about representing the world as they saw it. "I call on artists, be of your century. It is up to you to be the historians of your era, to recount it as you see it, to express it as you feel it, in all its aspects, in all of its forms, in all of its manifestations, through all of its vicissitudes and all of its magnitude." So one of the things that I think you'll find in many of these images is quite a bit about the sublime, right? The terrifying element of depicting the ravaged landscapes and peoples of Belgium's coal mining and metallurgical regions. Following his lead, painters including Pierre Paulus de Châtelet, Armand Rassenfors, Félicien Rops, Cécile Douard, and Everett Laroque, and photographers including Gustave Mauricio, all created images that helped to forge the identity for the Belgian industrial expansion of the late 19th century. Concentrated mainly in what was then called the Walloon region, French-speaking region, the images are at once a kind of celebration of and direct commentary on industry as they present the utter devastation of the landscape and the backbreaking labor associated with that landscape. And I just, for the sake of looking at some of the images that predate the turn of the century period, I have two images from the mid-19th century book, La Belgique Industrielle, Industrial Belgium, representing two different kinds of factories. 19th century Belgium was remarkable in a number of respects. It was the first country on the continent to experience the Industrial Revolution in the early years of the century. The comparative calm of the region, the availability of capital and labor, the presence of easily extractable natural resources, and its strategically important geographical position prompted financiers to invest in Belgian industry before they did so in Germany. From the middle of the century forward, Belgium secured a position as an industrial and commercial center on the continent. Industrialization had its greatest impact in the two regions that I mentioned before. And its agricultural richesse, which mainly was Flanders, the Rethier, I should go back, Flanders, the northern part of Belgium, was, and to this day, continues to be very much involved in agriculture, as does some of Wallonia. While much of the European continent was rocked by revolutionary violence and political turmoil in 1848, Belgium, a country whose own existence had been made possible through revolution 18 years earlier, did not face such upheaval. Despite this political tranquility, Belgium nonetheless was faced with long-term economic crises, which had direct consequences for its working-class citizens. In the textile industry, an industry that dominated Flanders, and in the metal and coal industries, through which the French-speaking region earned much of its capital, the economic recessions had devastating effects. Charlie, I'm using them kind of as foils because this is not the kind of painting that we'll be looking at. They are extraordinarily wonderful paintings and show the beauty of the Belgian landscape, the extreme greenness and cloudiness that has so many nuances in it. And that's one of the most wonderful elements associated with the paintings of the School of Terreuren and the later images. I want to move to the city of Brussels for a moment to talk about how the economic impact of the economic depressions had major ramifications in the city itself. You have to understand that during this time, Brussels received a huge influx of people who were suddenly out of work in the countryside, and there was extreme poverty and real starvation. In Belgium.
by Charles de Coux, one of the founders of the Société Mible des Beaux-Arts, his coffee grinder of 1857. I don't know if you can see them on the slides, but here on the back wall and here on the building itself are posters that refer to various problems. Homelessness, people needing jobs, people having jobs to present to others. And in the painting by Joseph Stebbins, who is a brother of Alfred Stebbins, whom you may know from wonderful paintings in pretty much every museum in this country. He was a manufacturing genius. And Joseph was the least known of the siblings, and he was particularly interested in painting dogs. But dogs in a certain way, and Brussels early morning, gives us a really strong indication of the kinds of work he did. If you look at the shadow back in here, you'll see two people looking for food in like a garbage can. And the dogs themselves fighting over little pieces of meat and so on. So using the figure of the dog actually is a real key critique of what was going on in Belgium. Another type of critique that comes into play, not quite a landscape, but very much about the topography of the city of Brussels, is Charles Hamon's At Dawn from 1875, where you see a group of people who might themselves be the subjects of Alfred Stebbins' paintings, very middle-class, upper-middle-class people who have stayed up all night drinking and being debauched. And they are confronted on the street by a family of coal miners who are out of work. So you see various kinds of critiques going on in the paintings of this period. Another type of critique that comes into play, this is a really funny slide because the painting of spring is quite small, and the painting of the chalk sellers is, well, every figure is life-size. So right at the bottom of the slide, I don't know if you can see it, are two palettes, just to give you a sense of scale, for the chalk sellers right here. And once again, this is a painting that asks us to identify with these poor people who really have nothing. They don't even have a home. And who are making the world of Brussels, which you see in the distance, possible. Other kinds of images in the center is, I'm sure, a painting that you've all had on exams and you've seen many times in the MFA, Jean-François Millet's or Millet's The Sower from 1850, and flanking the painting are an early work by Constantin Meunier from 1879, and a painting by Léon Frédéric, whose chalk sellers and spring you've just seen. So looking at peasants was terribly important for all of these artists. Thinking about their situation was key to their projects. And not just that, they sort of looked at how humans interacted with the landscape itself. In other words, one of the things that becomes very interesting about these, what we might call social realist works or realist works, as opposed to symbolist works, as opposed to expressionist works, is looking at the everyday trying to do it as unvarnished a term as possible. And rather than showing perhaps that a series of people who are plowing their fields, they might have, in some other instance, they might have a horse, or they might have a some kind of animal that would help them to create the furrows. These artists are actually showing really how tough it can be, not just how tough it might be for people in Belgium. And I show three different types of paintings. An oil on canvas by Theodor Verstraete of a man actually hauling not a plow but a boat, which is outside the margin of the painting, or Louis Pillon, whose grisaille paintings made of gray tones that you might have seen in Flemish altarpieces on the outside wings. Often the figures of saints are painted in gray form as if they're statues. And Louis Pion, an artist from Tournai, excelled in painting in that way. And Meunier's La Glèbe, which is a pastel on paper, extraordinary piece. Frédéric is a really interesting artist, and he's really not well known in this country at all. And he, as you know from the pieces upstairs, could create very idealized kinds of images, beautiful landscape paintings. We've already seen his critiques. And I just want to go back for a moment to the chalk cellars, because you know it's a triptych, right? That has all sorts of resonance with religious iconography and so on. We'll see that again later on. In the late 1890s, Frédéric made a multi-paneled painting, again a triptych, of the ages of the workers, and you see the central panel on the left-hand side. And a few years before, he made the ages of the peasants, five-panel painting of all the different types of moments in one's life, from young childhood, as we see here, to old age, through marriage, pregnancy, and so on. One of the things that I want you to look at, and I hope you can see it in the slide of the little boys, is many of them have crossed eyes. Many of them have very, very rosy cheeks. I showed this series of paintings to a physician not long ago, and I asked about what the physician saw, and what he said to me was, these are children whose malnourishment comes from in the fetus, and the look of the crossed eyes and so on is in itself an indicator of that. So, Frédéric, you know, on the one hand, I don't want to ruin these paintings for you. They are critiques. They're not innocent. They're very involved in sort of having us think about what's going on with the working class during this period. And another way to sort of think about it is that these were most of these artists were middle class, and who they were fascinated by what they were seeing, but they also were interested in helping them out. During this period, there's a huge move for various kinds of benevolent societies to help the working poor. And there were many different kinds of acts that came into play, including these commissions of labor that really evoke the needs of the people under study. Something else I want you to think about is this is the these little boys are the age of young kids who worked in the coal mines during this period. None of those, you got to wait until you're 16 to have a job outside of babysitting. These were children who started working as early as 7. And they worked for hours. The workday until 1893 in Belgium was 12 hours a day. There was no automatic and mandatory primary education. So these kids end up working really hard. By the time they're in adulthood, they've got black lung and various other kinds of diseases that come from breathing coal dust all the time. Boy, am I depressing you or what? It's really depressing stuff. But there's, you know, there are upsides to this story, and one of them I mentioned. Should I put this down, Nancy?
You might. Are you, is your back warm enough?
Yeah.
Okay.
Good.
Just a little bit down. Yeah, there you go. I think you're fine.
Okay. 1886, a very important date in the turn of the century. 1886 is the year that Zola's journal gets published in Belgium in serial form. 1886 is a labor commission that happens as a result of what you see on the screen now, which is a series of strikes. And I brought in a number of different strike imagery. The lower left-hand corner, the Meunier drawing, is from the 1886 strike itself. The others, and actually the Robert Kohler in this engraving, this is not meant to represent Belgium at all. It represented a strike in Germany. But when someone made an engraving on it, it was titled The Strike in the Charleroi Region, published in 1886. So there were a series of nationwide strikes in the industrial sector, in the cities, and so on, that caused Leopold to call for this commission of labor, commission of work, that began to think about how to make the working situation better for both children and women in particular. Didn't quite get as far as it should have done, but it caused a kind of national dialogue about what to do with workers. Just to give you a sense, Felicien Rops in the center. Felicien Rops is much better known for a very different kind of work. He was a pornographer. He illustrated some of the most wonderful, scary and horrifying texts from the 19th century. He married two sisters and lived happily ever after in his chateau in Essonne, where he died surrounded by his two sisters and their children in 1898. He was very much not someone who followed social practices. and he was extraordinary, but this is one of his famer images. But I think it's also really important to note that in his image of the strike, and again you see the posters on the back wall that talk about the strike itself and about a ball, a union ball, figure of the strike is a woman. That this was not typical in the representations of the strikes during this period. In a sense, Rupps was using the gender of the word, la grève, which is a feminine noun, and sort of seeing her kind of as a personification of the strike, but also, and as we'll see later on, as a yercheuse, a woman who hauled bags of coal, one of the many women in the coal mines, they became subjects of artists who wanted to sort of create almost titillating kinds of imagery. This is a very tame version of that, but eventually you will see. 1884, 1886, a very important book was published called La Belgique. It was a 700 and some odd page text written by the novelist Camille Lemonnier, who eventually became a nephew of Meunier because he married one of Meunier's relation, nieces. He commissioned Xavier Mellery, whose work you see upstairs, and Meunier, amongst other artists, to travel around Belgium with him to represent the wonders of the country. And one whole section is Aino, which is the area, the coal mining district. And most of those images were created by Mellery and Constantin Meunier. Constantin Meunier, who had been trained as a sculptor, only returned to painting in about 1879. So this is a very early moment in his career. But what becomes very interesting is that these illustrations are used in his paintings and sometimes in his reliefs eventually. Some additional images. And it's not just that the world is scorched outside, it's scorched inside. Meunier painted eventually a whole slew of images inside the rolling mills, inside the puddling labs, and so on, where you see people working usually with no shirts on, and if they're lucky, a leather apron, as you see in the image on the left, working with molten metal. This was an industry that caused many different kinds of maimings of the workers who were involved. Puddling, getting the pig iron separated from the slag, is something that took about an hour to do, and it was a constant turning of the dowel. The dowel itself weighed about 40 pounds, and the metal that they had to pull could go up to about 200 pounds. So you can imagine that this was not something that people could do for many, many years without without destroying their bodies and or probably getting injured in some way. But it's very important to sort of think about these are the bodies that are making the Belgian enterprise possible in the 1880s. Something else that came into existence during this period is the Parti Ouvrier Belge, the Workers' Party that became the Socialist Party. And I gave you the quote from Jules Destrée early on. And part of what Jules Destrée did, he was married to a woman named Louise Danse, who was the daughter of a printmaker named Auguste Danse. And he became very interested in the arts. He became very friendly with Monet, became very friendly with a lot of other artists, and he created an art section at the People's House, which was the headquarters for the Workers' Party. And the reason I mention this is because one of the things that these artists did, and they're not to help various benevolent organizations or to help different kinds of groups that were particularly injured in some way. So you can find all sorts of products that Monet or prints and drawings and even sculptures done for such kinds of things. And that comes out of this founding of the Workers' Party, that the idea that if you have a party, a political party, that is very much focused on one particular class of people, then that helps to sort of raise the stakes for everyone. And it's real hard for me to get away from Monet, and several more pieces. One last image from the view of the city of Mons from the castle, which is on a hill. Mons was, as you saw in the lower left hand corner. So what does that make it? The southwestern side of the one of the seats of the coal mining industry, and I show you another piece from my collection, which I received as a gift, of the coal miners' houses in the town of Petrovaj. Two additional images of panoramas of the coal mining region, and you can see that this was an area that never really got blue skies, right? Because the chimneys were constantly belching. Catherine Labadie has a beautiful quote from Victor Hugo in her essay for the catalog that talks about that moment of discovery of the factory and the hallucinations that he found in seeing the belching and heat and smell and so on. Very visceral kinds of analyses. Meunier himself, when he first came to the industrial sector, said, "Oh, I woke up a new man. I could not continue doing the work I had done because of this ferocious, sort of scary." I can give you the quote, the real quote, eventually. But it was very important for him. It was like a coup de foudre, you know, love at first sight. That it was for him. These were sort of endless regions, and I just want to give you a sense of what they actually look like. These are some period photographs and some more recent photographs, and I bet you're wondering what that little hill is. Right? These are not natural formations. These are slag heaps that have grown over. And become vegetated. And if you take the fast train from Brussels to Paris, if you look out your window at a certain moment, you see some of these, what are called tippy slag heaps. And that's very important. And what becomes so interesting to think about, and this is the subject of another paper, is postcards and how people used postcards of the industrial sector. It's hard for me to imagine that, and you can go to any flea market in Belgium and find them all over the place. Or in the International Exposition of 1905 in Liège, very important industrial exposition, they created a replica of a slag heap and then had people be photographed in front of the slag heap as if tourists looking at industry as a kind of entertainment, which I find really interesting mm-hmm. to think about. Meunier spent a lot of time in the coal mining region. He painted and drew and etched this area by day, by night, in the summer, in the winter. And part of the reason for that is that one of his daughters married the engineer at the coal mine of Cuillé. And so he was at the coal mine all the time. He was at another coal mine in 1887 when visiting with the doctor for the coal mine when the call came out that a fire damp had occurred. What's a fire damp? That's when noxious fumes asphyxiate everyone inside. If you, recent past, there was a movie made about the coal miners, the 33 coal miners who survived days stuck in the coal mines. You don't want to get stuck in these things. They're claustrophobic to begin with, and the danger is inherent automatically, and you can hit a stone wrong and it can cause a fire damp. So think about those children in the coal mines, right? Think about what their jobs might be, and I'll tell you what their jobs were. Have you ever heard of the phrase canary in the coal mine? Mm-hmm. The canary is not a bird, it's a little boy. And that is really horrifying. They would crawl ahead of the people working and hitting the stones to see where the veins might be. It's utterly fascinating to think about and utterly horrifying. But this is a landscape that's never without fire, right? It's always burning, just like the oil fields in Texas are always burning, right? Because in order to reap the oil, you have to burn off the noxious chemicals. I want to bring your attention to the image of the three coal miners walking, and you'll see a Yersheuse, a haulage woman, positioned prettily, but just walking with her sabot, her wooden shoes, along with her friends, one carrying an axe, one carrying a miner's lamp, and talking as they are returning from the mine. The idea of the day of a mine work, set of mine workers, is something that Meunier painted as well, circa 1900, in a huge, again, almost life-sized figures of the triptych of the mine, Triptyque de la Mine. And he used the term triptyque, which evokes, again, the religious iconography of the altarpiece. And this was something that he did very purposefully. And each of the panels has a name that's also associated with the sacrifice of Christ. And I find that really interesting to sort of think about in this context. And just so you know how people would go into the mines, here's a period photograph of the cages filled with people either coming up or going down. Quite extraordinary. And if you've ever been in a mine, you go down hundreds of feet in these elevators. The slag heap itself became a subject for artists. Cécile Douard, who lived in the city of Mons, and who went blind soon after this painting was produced. It's an extraordinary painting. And you see not individuals, but almost like rats climbing up the slag heap with someone at the top tossing over the cart that will give them the opportunity to glean, if you will, to take the leftovers of the coal. Meunier's drawing of a yercheuse on the side of the mountain similarly shows the sort of that the mountain is not, the slag heap is not, it's not dry, it's not cool, it's warm. These are things, these are stones that have just come out of the earth, right? And you think about how that functions. So this woman traipsing up the hill is really typical of how women worked. And just because I think it's important to sometimes have statistics, I'm an art historian, I'm not a social historian, but I think it is sometimes useful. This is a census that was done on little boys and little girls starting at age 10 in the coal mines in 1879. And I just give you that to sort of ponder while I talk about the fact that in 1893, it became illegal for children to work in the coal mines. They could work on the surface, but they could no longer work in the coal mines, except that I have a drawing by Meunier that I purchased at auction about a decade ago that's from 1902, and it shows a young coal mining boy. And one wonders about whether or not this was someone who worked inside still. Some photographs by Gustave Mauricio, a photographer based in Liège who was commissioned by the coal mining companies to create a set of slides that then could be taken around to talk about the wonderful things that are going on in the Belgian coal mines. And so he made photographs of pretty much everything associated with the labor of the coal mine. And I just bring in two images of women working on slag heaps. Image which starts to show the difference between Meunier's image of the women who are like beasts of burden, kind of like their peasant farmer counterparts. Here we have a yekshos posed in about as sexy a Kim Kardashian way as is possible, with the head across the shoulder and so on, sort of as if her breasts are being emphasized if we look at the man looking at her chest. These are more typical of images of coal mining women, including this image of the kiss of the overseer. And when I was putting this slide into the lecture, I couldn't help but think about Harvey Weinstein. And because there are many, many, many reports about overseers taking advantage of the young women in coal mines. So we don't know in this instance, but I couldn't help it as I was thinking about it. And several other images by Anand Hassenfors, another Liège artist who worked with Felician Ropes on printmaking techniques. The artists of this period also rendered the strikes. You saw Meunier's image of the 1886 strike at the beginning of the lecture, and now we have representations of the 1893 strike, which brought about the most important labor laws to that point. Two images by Larmans, and if I did this scale-wise, the little etching would be really small, and the painting would be really big. That's the magic of PowerPoint. And just to sort of end with another part of the industrial landscape that artists rendered. We have George Lemon's painting that's from RISD on display upstairs, and an Antwerp artist, Pierre Palus de Châtelet, his rendering of the ship's camel. The camel is the mechanism by which produce and other materials would be unladen or laden. And just like we saw in the coal mines that houses encroach the slag heaps, meaning that they're in the space of the industry, so too is the case in the maritime element, and it's not for nothing that Pierre Palus called this painting Maternité, motherhood, and the mother and her two children are surrounded by belching smokestacks and so on. And just to close, two photographs of present-day Belgium. The coal mine were all closed at the latest by 2008. The coal industry doesn't exist in Belgium anymore. Much of the coal industry had stopped